Infectious disease outbreaks more likely to occur in the rats. There are probably many reasons for infectious disease to occur in rats. However, I would like to mention four reasons that have more importance here. These are four reasons. Fish loading densities greater than those used in farm. Second is continuous production strategies. Prolonged water retention in system provides extended residence time that allows for growth of opportunistic and overly virulent pathogens, relatively more stressful environment. Why does it matter? Because running a facility without a biosecurity and fish heat management plan will result in this cost when an infectious disease outbreak occurs. Note also that the higher capital and production cost of the circulation system means that the consequence of infectious disease outbreaks can be catastrophic. Risk management equals to biosecurity. So what I say, why does it matter? Because the running of facility without a biosecurity and fish heat management plan will result in this cost when an infectious disease outbreak occurs. Note also that the higher capital and production cost of the circulating system means that the consequence of infectious disease outbreaks can be a catastrophe. So risk management equals biosecurity. What's the definition of biosecurity? FAO has defined biosecurity as follows. The sum total of activities and measures taken by aquaculture production facility to protect the aquaculture stocks from the possible negative impact resulting from the introduction and spread of serious aquatic animal disease. Biosecurity refers to activities with the goal: first, prevent; second, control; third, eradicate risk to life and health; the fourth, reduce the economic impact disease. So something is changed again, maybe. So what exactly biosecurity? The biosecurity involves the practice, procedures and policy used to prevent the introduction and spread of disease-causing organisms. For example, bacteria, viruses, fungi, parasites, as well as many aquatic invasive species. For example, zebra mussel and plastic flyfish. Fish disease continue to be one of the greatest causes of economic loss for the industry, accounted for millions of dollars in animal loss to fish producers. While some fish pathogens are well-known problems, other diseases are emerging or spread to previously unaffected areas. Outbreaks can happen rapidly and spread quickly, often resulting in high mortality. It is difficult to predict when disease might occur. However, the written use biosecurity measures can reduce the risk, introduction, and economic impact of disease. State this, please. Assessing your farm for needed biosecurity measures first requires a basic understanding of how disease can spread on your farm and the risk, various risk factors for transmission. This will help you to identify, assess, and prioritize the specific risk areas for your farm and determine what measures will help reduce those risks. Please change. Know that we have a basic understanding of how the organism can be spread. Let's look at some of the risk factors for disease introduction onto the fish farm. As we discussed the risk factors, as if you can identify how the disease transmission can occur, This will help you identify prevention measures to use to reduce the risk. The main risk factor for disease introduction onto an aquaculture facility are fish movement, water source, factor impacted on fish heat, contaminated equipment and vessels, and also vector transmission. The movement of fish onto, within, or off the farm is greatest risk factor for disease introduction and spread in aquaculture. New fish brought to the farm for breeding, grow out, or restocking may introduce pathogens to resident fish. This may include purchased fish or eggs, if not disinfected, as well as wild stock. Fish that have been taken off farm and then returned may also pose a disease risk, especially if they have been commingled with other fish. Keep mind that for some disease, fish may be infected without showing signs of illness. These carrier fish can then serve as potential source of infection to other fish. To prevent disease introduction on your farm, purchase food from known and trusted suppliers. These fish should be inspected and found free of important disease. Limit the number of source fish are purchased from and frequency and the number of new introduction onto your farm. When possible, purchase egg or fish from certified disease-free broodstock. This may not be applicable for all fish species cultured. Egg should be disinfected upon arrival. When appropriate, vaccinate newly acquired fish for disease. Once fish are brought to your farm, minimize the transfer of disease to resident fish by isolating new arrivals before adding them to your current stock. This includes fish recently purchased as well as fish returned to farm. The length of quarantine is variable and depends on the disease of concern. 4 to 6 weeks is commonly suggested. Keep in mind some diseases are also temperature related and seeking may be seen until optimal water temperature occurs. Quarantine area should be located away from resident fish and should have separate water source or flow circuit and any water inflow on or off the farm. From the quarantine area should be managed to avoid contaminating water source or fish production areas. Dedicated equipment should be used in for quarantine area to avoid vomit transfer to resident fish. Care of fish in quarantine area, for example feeding, cleaning, should occur after resident fish by an employee assigned solely to the care and handling of the quarantined fish. Many disease-causing organisms can be transferred through water source, for example, surface water source. Use pathogen-free water source, such as web, spring, or other groundwater source when possible. Surface water source should be avoided as they have a great potential for carrying fish pathogens. If the use of pathogen-free source is not possible, disinfection of water supply by ozonation or ultraviolet radiation may be needed. Filtration of water source can help exclude the introduction of unwanted aquatic species from your water source. The impact of fish disease may result in direct losses due to illness or mortality. However, effect may be more indirect, such as a decrease in production. For example, reduced growth rate, feed conversion efficiency, or product quality. Optimum heat of your fish is essential and greatly improve their ability to fight of infection. This is achieved by minimizing stress, maintaining appropriate water quality parameters, and proper nutrition, moving potential infectious disease source, and monitoring and maintaining fish production and heat records. The susceptibility of fish to disease is greatly influenced by stress. A number of parameters in aquaculture can increase stress in fish, including high stocking densities, improper water quality parameters, and poor nutrition. Minimize stress in your fish by keeping stocking densities within acceptable parameters. Limit transfer of fish between units or location when possible. When moving fish, use gentle clothing and fish handling methods. Maintain optimum water quality. Fluctuations or improper maintenance of water quality parameters can predispose fish to disease. This includes temperature, as many fish pathogens have an optimal temperature range for infectivity, and fish human systems are infected by water temperature. Provide proper nutrition. Store feed in cool, dry place, and use feed within 3 to 6 months. This helps to maintain vitamins and mineral stability in the feed, as well as reduce the potential of moldy feed. Keep feed in areas secured from vectors, for example, rodents, birds. Clean up any secreted feed to avoid attraction of birds and rodents. If raw fish are used as feed, to be sure to obtain a healthy fish from reliable resource. Remove dead or dying fish. Monitor fish frequently for disease. Employees should know the major signs of illness in fish and who to contact when those are noted. Early identification of fish disease can help minimize its spread and impact on your farm. Ill or dead fish should be removed immediately, as they can serve as potential disease sources to remaining stock. Dying fish should be promptly and humanely euthanized. Disposal should be in accordance with local and state laws, and in manner that predators or wild birds cannot access carcasses and further secrete the disease. Ill fish should be removed and placed in a isolated area away from current fish stocks. This area, similar to quarantine, should have dedicated equipment and water source. Care or treatment of these fish should occur after healthy resident fish or by an employee solely dedicated to the area. When signs of illness are noted, contact your aquatic veterinarian or fish health specialist immediately. Necropsy and testing of ill fish can help identify a potential infectious disease before it becomes widespread on your farm. Maintenance and monitoring of fish production and health records can help to detect disease problems and highlight their severity, and often provide clues for disease diagnosis. Maintain accurate records of fish illness and deaths. Keep records on fish production parameters, such as growth and feed conversion ratio, to aid in detecting subclinical disease problems. Records all new introduction or returning fish, their source and movements on or off the farm. This can help identify potential disease entry points in the event of a disease break. Maintain records of any treatments or vaccination or clear disease conditions. Many disease causing agents can survive in environment for variable amounts of time. For this reason, any equipment, for example, net, buckets, scale, boats, rudder, or even vessels used to work with oars, move fish can serve as a potential source of disease transfer between facilities and units. Any equipment used at aquaculture facility should be cleaned and thoroughly dried, preferably in direct sunlight or chemically disinfected before being used in another location. Fish production tank, raceways, and ponds should be disinfected between each lot of fish. Construction materials should be non-porous and easy to clean and disinfect. Avoid to use wood, as it's hard to disinfect completely. If you use it, should be limited to temporary structures and should never be transferred to another site. Food tips should be placed near the entrance to animal areas. Food and water should be cleaned and submerged for an appropriate period of time prior to and after leaving the area. Food tip solutions should be changed daily or when visibility is soiled with debris. Tools and equipment should not be shared between sites. If possible, dedicated equipment or vessel should be used. If it is not possible, this item should be cleaned and disinfected between fish loads or farms. Any residual water or debris should be removed. Bilge water from boats should be removed and disinfected. Vessel cleaning should include the wells, dryers, and undercarriage. Wash station should be provided on scene, away from animal production areas. You can see here the selected disinfectant for aquaculture. I here give four product for example. One of them is sodium chloride, another one iodine. So next column content is concentration, the another part of use and the precaution. You can, when you use this disinfectant, you can use this table and this products. As previously mentioned, living creatures such as fish, praying, birds or other wild predators or vermin can secrete disease agent. This may occur by carrying the pathogen on their body or feet or by dropping fish or fish part at the other location. This also includes domestic animals that may travel between farms. Pathogens transfer between farms and wild fish populations. It's an equal importance consideration. People can also serve as vectors, transferring pathogens during handling or on their feet or clothing. This includes various visitors to farm, for example, delivery personnel, transport personnel, salesmen, or the general public or employees. Contact between your fish and other animals that may present a risk of disease introduction. This includes wild fish stock, predators, domestic animals, for example, dogs and cats, and wildlife traveling between farms. Implement predator management and rodent control program. Contact your local extension office for legal control measures. Biosecurity measures must protect cultured fish from contact with wild species as well as prevent the escape of infected cultured fish or runoff of contaminated water source or inlet. Visitors to the farm, especially those coming from areas where they have been exposed to fish disease, they serve as a vector for introduction of disease. These include should take measures to minimize potential risk of the disease transfer. This includes wearing clean overalls and disposable or disinfected rubber boots while on farm. Maintain a log visitors to your farm. All visitors on your farm should be accompanied by farm personnel during their visit. When possible, these individuals should avoid animals, areas, and restricted from contacting and handling your fish. Employees should wear clean clothing, overalls, and footwear when working with fish and wash, and sanitize their hands when moving between areas. Food tips for disinfecting footwear should also be used between these areas. Employees should perform tasks in area from lowest risk to highest risk. For example, inside tanks to outside tanks, from most susceptible to least susceptible population. For example, fry or fingerlings to adults. Personnel should save quarantine or isolation work for last. Access to egg incubation and fry facility should be restricted to a minimum number of well-trained individuals. Here is an example of fermentation program. The first column contains what to remember. The second one, how is it done? For example, first one, a clean source of new water. Previously use groundwater. Disinfect using ultraviolet. In some case, sun filter or ozone can be used. Also, this is contains disinfection of system, disinfection of equipment and surface, disinfection of eggs, staff and visitors. This is a kind of helpful tool you can use in your farm. Any person or employees can see easily. So become implementation. Once you have determined the biosecurity measures you will implement on your farm, it is important to communicate these employees and visitors to your farm. Having a written plan ensures those affect will have access to the necessary procedures, and in many cases is becoming a requirement of the inspection of process for transport equipment. Once biosecurity measures are implemented, it is also important to assess how they are working. As a conclusion, as the aquaculture industry continues to grow, the threat of infectious disease to fish production facility will continue. New disease pathogens are being discovered or are emerging to new locations, while the risk of disease in production settings cannot be completely eliminated. The use of biosecurity measures on the farm can help you to prevent disease in production and spread and protect your fish, your farm, and your investment. Here are the further reading and resources. There is one guide to recirculation aquaculture. It's a useful, it's a published by FAO. Another one I recommend, the FAO Biosecurity Toolkit. It's also very useful. Also, you can use internet to find biosecurity and management plan in RAS. Thank you very much listening to me. Thank you very much, Mato, your help.